Holy Mary Sunday was celebrated beginning in the early 1200 AD. St. Francis of Assisi recognized the value of joy and laughter when he advised, "Leave sadness to the devil. The devil has reason to be sad." Martin Luther shared his belief when he stated, "God is not the God of sadness, but the devil is. Christ is the God of joy. It is pleasing to God whenever you rejoice from the bottom of your heart." John Wesley was much briefer in his description of happiness as a Christian. "Sour godliness is the devil's religion," is what he said. By the way, the shirt says, "The Sermonator." My daughter gave me that for Christmas. And you don't get to wear that very often in an appropriate situation. So today I am the Sermonator. But what does a Sermonator do? Well, a Sermonator empowers a congregation to go out and terminate sin. That's what they are all about. Welcome to Holy Hillary Sunday. You are invited to have an Easter lap at the devil's expense. Christ is risen. Enjoy. Will you please stand? Call to worship. Call to worship. On the first day of the week, we anoint his body with spices. They discovered that his body was not there. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth. This is the joke of Easter.
The devil has lost his victory over Jesus.
And death. So put a smile on the inside of your face.
And the outside will take care of itself.
Laughter is cooperation with God.
Our Creator is happy God. Christ came to bring joy.
Laughter is good medicine.
Be your own physician. Try to have a great way.
A smile is a passport to happy living.
And his healing power is unlimited.
Positive people aren't always right.
They are positive.
A laugh at our expense.
Often proves to be a positive investment.
Happiness is not an accident.
It's where it shows in
the end. Every soul is a depository.
With the Spirit of God.
So smile.
It's good for the face.
And it's good for the soul. Now, the hymns are going to be a little bit different today. This hymn that we're going to be singing, the words will be up there. Please note that with the other hymns, there's time when you hum, when you whistle, when you la la la, and when you sing the words. So there's no excuse when we come to the humming and the whistling and the la 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 that everybody doesn't participate.
Thank you.
of the deal, lose my interest and my zeal, strike a bargain and make a deal, turn our friend into a deal, Bales, thank you for a meal, underrate your love of deal.
Spirit, enter into my zeal and take away our sins for real. Rejoice, your sins are forgiven. Please be seated. Holy Scriptures. Joy appears in the Scriptures 183 times. Rejoice 153 times. From the third chapter of Ecclesiastes. For everything there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven. A time to weep and a time to laugh. Psalm 2, verse 4. God who sits in heaven laughs. Psalm 30, verse 11. God, you have turned my mourning into dancing. You have taken off my sackcloth and clothed me with joy. Psalm 126, first part of 2, chapter, verse 2. Then our mouth was filled with laughter, and our tongue with shouts of joy. Proverbs 17, 22. A cheerful heart is good medicine. Nehemiah 8:10, which is my verse. The joy of the Lord is my strength. Please join me in the prayer of the day, which, by the way, is the Clouds Prayer. Lord, as we stumble through the joys and sorrows of life, eyes of a child, and the twinkle in the eyes of the aged. And so they said, could we you know, join you and play a foursome? Sure. So they played 9 holes, and they said, that was so much fun, let's play another 9 holes. So they played another 9 holes. The gentleman went home and told his wife about it. His wife said, yeah, scantily clad, three scantily clad young women, I bet you really enjoyed that. And he said, not really, it was probably the most miserable day that I've ever played golf in. Have you ever tried to hold your stomach in for 18 holes?
Okay, I've got a couple of things. First one, here a few Sundays ago, it was up in Keister. There was everybody was coming in for Sunday's worship services, and everybody's getting in their favorite pews, and they're all sitting around. They're just talking about their week and the kids and everything. And then all of a sudden, in the front, a big flash of lightning and thunder, and there the devil was in the pulpit. Everybody's like, oh my gosh, they're just so afraid. And said, what normal people do is they ran. They tried to get away from the devil, and everybody ran out of the sanctuary, except one old farmer, sitting just calmly in the pew, and the devil looked at him. What are you doing? Don't you fear me? Don't you know who I am? And he said, yeah, I'm the devil. So, I'm evil incarnate. You should fear me. You should run from me. Why aren't you afraid? And the old farmer says, I've been married to your sister for 40 years.
All right. Go ahead.
Sven and Ole hadn't been on a vacation for a while, so they decided to go on a safari to Africa. And while they were in Africa, they were wandering through the bush, and they came upon a lion that was looked like he hadn't had a meal for a while. And Sven bent over and started to tie his shoes really tight, like he was going to take off running. And Ole says to Sven, he says, "Sven, you're foolish. You can't outrun a lion." And Sven says to Ole, "But Ole, I don't have to outrun the lion. I only have to outrun you."
One over here. And then we got one over here, and then we'll have the text.
What did Batman say to Robin before they got in the car?
I don't know. What did Batman say to Robin before he got in the car?
Get in the car, Robin.
Yeah, one more here. Yeah.
Anyway, I just got back from Arizona, and it's an older community. And this is an example of what happened down there. There's three guys walking down the street. And the first guy says, "Sure is windy today." The second guy says, "It's not Wednesday, it's Thursday." And the third guy says, "Well, I'm thirsty too. Let's go have a beer."
Okay, I take that personally, but my wife and I are thinking about moving to Arizona. In the text for this morning, we see that there's some laughter in the Bible as well. We'll wait with the joke. We got another time, so we'll get to. So hang on to it, and we'll get to that.
At times, God's good news seems so far-fetched that it makes us laugh out loud. So it was with Sarah. She was barely far beyond childbearing age when she heard the three men, the angels, declare to have a baby in their old age. The good news of God is that He has made miracles come true, so that Isaac, whose name means laughter, can be born into our lives as well. The lesson is from the 18th chapter of Genesis, beginning with the first verse. The Lord appeared to Abraham by the oath of manner as he sat at the tent, so his tent in the heat of the day. He looked up and saw three men standing near him. When he saw them, he ran to the tent entrance to meet them, and they bowed down to the ground. He said, "My Lord, if I find favor with you, do not pass by your servant. Let a little water be brought, and wash your feet, and rest yourself under the tree. Let me bring a little bread that you may refresh yourself, and after that you may pass on, since you have come to your servant." So they said, Do as you have said. And Abraham hastened into the tent to Sarah and said, "Make ready quickly three measures of choice flour, knead it, and make cakes." Abraham ran into the herd and took a calf, tender and good, and gave it to the servant, who hastened to prepare it. Then he took curds and milk, and the calf that he had prepared, and set it before them. And he stood by them under the tree while they ate. They said to him, "Where is your wife Sarah?" And he said, "There in the tent." Then one said, "I will surely return to you in the due season, and your wife will have a son." And Sarah was listening at the tent entrance behind him. Now Abraham and Sarah were old, advanced in age. It had crossed to be with Sarah after the manner of women. So Sarah laughed herself, saying, "After I have grown old and my husband is old, shall I have pleasure?" The Lord said to Abraham, "Why did Sarah laugh and say, 'Shall I indeed bear a child and now that I am old? Is anything too wonderful for the Lord?' At the set time I will return to you in due season, and Sarah shall have a son." But Sarah denied, saying, "I did not laugh," for she was afraid. He said, "Oh yes, you did laugh." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The second lesson is from Philippians 4, verses 4 through 7. The author of Philippians encourages us to always look at the positive side of life because God is with us, we are encouraged to rejoice always. It reads, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I would say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, and in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. The word of the Lord.
Satan means body. Satan wants you. He has a lot of tools out there. A lot of tools out there, especially on the internet. There is pornography. There are all kinds of lies out there. There is violence. I don't see many of the games that the kids play, but so many of them are violent. And yet they go to school and say, don't be a bully. You have to make a decision on it. Satan has tools, and he wants to creep into your mind like a virus. And he wants you. So be careful that you are not doing Satan's work in this world. Watch your language. Watch what you do. Watch who you proclaim. You can laugh at the devil because he is a created being and has been defeated and cast into hell. But laugh at the devil in Christ's power, in his resurrection. We can laugh at the devil because he is a created being. But of course, the ultimate way to laugh at the devil is because of Easter. Oh, let me tell you, Satan thought that he had Jesus, the Son of God, absolutely controlled when he had his hands around his neck. And he got the world, he got the church, he got a whole nation to kill him. And he was dancing like crazy. But he can't keep a good man down, especially when he's a God man. What did Jesus do during that time when he was dead? He went down into hell or Hades, the abode of the dead. And for everybody who have not heard about Jesus, he was there and gave them a second chance. A second chance. I would guess that really angered Satan. But not half as much as Easter morning. When Jesus was raised from the dead, death was conquered, sin was paid for, and it was given to the world as a free gift. Who loved Jesus? The ultimate joke was played on the great deceiver. When Satan thought as a victory, what was a victory, turned into defeat. The con artist was caught. So we can laugh at the devil in the power of the risen Lord Jesus Christ. And on all your Good Fridays, remember, Sunday's coming. Caution. The devil is really, really difficult. And he wants to take as many as possible of us to hell. We can laugh at his defeat, but we dare not taunt the devil. Instead, give a Rhesus Paschala, an Easter lamb, by the power of the risen Lord Jesus Christ. Finally, we can laugh because it is our victory, personally. I don't know how many Lutherans I've asked, you live in your saving, they say, well, I think so, or I hope so. You know, if you believe the word of God, stop saying that, because that's the devil's words. Yes, I am, and stand on it by the power of the cross. And how are we joined to the power of the cross? Through our own baptism. In Romans 6, it says that we are joined into Christ through his suffering, death, and above all, his resurrection. In our holy baptism, each one of us personally has been claimed by God, adopted by God. We are his. We have the victory over death, sin, and the power of the devil. It is not just Jesus' victory, it is our victory that he gives to us as a free gift. We can have an Easter laugh. That's what we're all about, is that Easter laugh. Victory is ours. Jesus lives in us. Amen. He is risen.
He is risen.
He is risen.
He is risen.
1. Laugh at the devil. Live in Jesus' victory over sin, death, and the power of the devil. Amen. Please stand for when we sing Joy to the World. That tune should be familiar. The words should be familiar. Please note that we sing the first verse, whistle the second verse, hum the third verse, and sing the fourth verse.
Just say, Satan, get you behind me, and you will be fine. Well, a few days later, a woman in the congregation was going shopping. And before she went, her husband told her, "Now you remember, if you're tempted to do something you know you shouldn't do, just say, 'Satan, get you behind me,' and you will be fine." Well, lo and behold, she comes home with a really expensive, beautiful outfit. And her husband confronted her and said, "Don't you remember what the pastor said? You should say, 'Satan, get you behind me,' and you would be fine." She said, "I did. Say, 'Satan, get behind me.'" And he said, "It looks really good from here, too."
Raise your hand and then read it to you. While they're doing that, Adam and Eve were in the Garden of Eden, and Adam came home late one evening, and Eve goes, "Where were you?" "Well, with another woman." And Adam goes, "It's only one woman. It's you. I mean, God didn't create more than just you." So they were sleeping at night, and he woke up, and he was kind of being tickled. And he says, "What are you doing, Eve?" And she says, "Counting your ribs." Somebody over here?
Yeah, there was a college freshman that was in his room, and he got to save money, he told his roommate. So he went out and bought all these cookbooks. And his roommate got home one day, and he says, "Well, I bought all these cookbooks, but we're not going to be able to make any of the recipes." And the roommate says, "Why? Is it so difficult?" "No, everyone starts out the same way. Take a clean bowl." The new minister was walking down the street, and there was a young boy waiting outside the store for his mother to come out. And the minister says, "Say, I'm the new minister on White Street. Can you tell me how to find the post office?" "Yeah," the boy said, "well, go down to the corner, take a right, it's right there." "Oh, great, then thank you so much. Say, I invite you to come to church on Sunday. I'll show you how to get to heaven." And the little boy chuckled and he says, "Yeah, right. And you can't even find the post office."
Who else? Well, a couple more over here. Go ahead, Eric.
The Catholic, and they had two boys. And the oldest one was 6 years old, and he was invited to go to a pizza party for the boy's birthday party. So when he got in the car, kid that was celebrating his birthday said, "We're going to the Pizza Hut and have pizza." And our grandboy said, "Oh, I love that all-meat pizza at the Pizza Hut." Well, he said, "You're a Catholic. You can't meet on Friday." Yeah, he said, "But my mother's a Lutheran."
Ole, Sven, and Lars, they were in a bad car accident, and they went up to the pearly gates, and St. Peter met them there. St. Peter says, "You can't get in unless you answer a question. Now, do you know what Easter is?" And Lars says, "Yeah, I know what Easter is. Easter is when you get your family together and you have a turkey." And then Nita brings that good pie. Says, "No, can't get it." Well, Sven, do you know what Easter is? He says, "Yeah, I know what Easter is. Easter is when you get the big tree. And then you have turkey again, and you get presents, and Nita brings that good pie again." Says, "No, you can't get in." So they asked Ole, of course, he's so smart. "Ole, what's Easter?" "Oh, I know what Easter is. Easter's when they take Jesus and he gets in trouble and they crucify him and hang him on a cross. And then they put him in the big cave and then there's a big stone around him." And St. Peterson was so impressed that he knew this. He says, "Yeah. And then when it's April Fool's, he comes out. He comes out, and if he sees a shadow, it's 3 more or 6 more weeks of winter."
Well, go ahead.
Okay. So there was a pastor. He had an appointment. So he was trying to find a spot for it. And he couldn't find a spot. So he wrote to an officer, "I circled the block 100 times. Forgive us our trespasses." He came back and it said, "I circled this block for 10 years. If I don't give you a ticket, I'm going to get fired. Lead us not into temptation."
but he was a great avid golfer. And so early one spring, raise your hands, that's okay. Early one spring, it was a nice day, beautiful day. So the pastor called Scott, the council president, and says, "I'm sorry, but I can't come in. I have a cold and my voice is a lucky thing." And he drove 50 miles down the road where nobody would recognize him, where the golf course was open. He went up and started golfing. He teed off for the first time, and it was a hole in one. God said, I'm going to punish him. And the angel said, "You're going to punish him? How are you going to do that? He made a hole in one on his first tee off." God said, "Who can you tell?"
Yeah. All right, Pastor Joel had taught on Sunday that it would be good to have a visual demonstration along with the sermon. So he had four worms, and he put them each in a jar. And in one jar, he put whiskey in with the worm, and the other jar put a bunch of cigarette smoke in there, and the third jar was chocolate syrup. That's what it was, chocolate syrup. And the fourth jar, he put nice clean soil. So anyway, in the sermon, at the end, he said, "Well, I'd have to show the congregation something. The first jar of the whiskey, worm is dead. Second worm with the cigarette smoke, the worm is dead. The third worm with the chocolate syrup is dead. And the fourth worm is thriving, of course, in the good soil." And so the pastor Joel says, "What does that show everybody?" As one old lady in the back says, "That if you drink whiskey, smoke cigarettes, and eat chocolate syrup, you won't have worms."
This time we'll receive our joyful offering. And I'm going to do something a little different because I didn't put the announcements in, so I'm going to do the announcements at this time. And Scott, I'm going to call on you right away.
Good morning. Just wanted to update the congregation a little bit about Pastor Joel and conformance and clarify things. He called me the other day, and he will be leaving Washington, D.C., their home, on the 7th of April, which will be this week. They're going to arrive in Lake Valence on Monday the 11th, is their plan. Not sure, just when they're going to be able to move their belongings into their new house up the street here. It's open by Friday of that week. His first Sunday of preaching will be April 24th. A couple reasons for that. He's got to have a little time to get settled in his new house. He needs to go up and see his new grandchild in the cities. And his mother-in-law recently entered a care center, and he promised his wife that they would go spend some time with her. But in the, between April 11th and April 24th, he's going to be spending time with the confirmation kids a few days. He's going to be in the office, and he's going to be possibly meeting with some of the various committees of the council. So that's kind of the timeline on Pastor Joel and his wife. And one thing I'd like to say is that we talked about him last week. Four or five times he made this reference to wanting to get here, wanting to get to know people in the congregation, wanting to get out of the community and meet people, and wanting to get over to the school and meet the faculty and kids and be part of the community. So I thought that was really neat. It wasn't a scripted thing he told me, it was just kind of thing in conversation. So I'm very happy to hear that. We have set up with the Senate for Sunday, May 15th, to the installation of Pastor Joel. The council meeting will start making plans about what we're going to do that day. So another thing I'd like to bring up is the worship and music committee is going to be working with Pastor Joel right away on service time, and what we're going to do for the summer, and then in the summer they're going to work on what we're going to do for the fall. And if anybody has any strong feeling one way or another, please get a hold of Bruce Adams. He's the chair of the worship and music, or several of the others on the committee, like Kathy Chose, Kathy Charleston, Linda Helgeson, and Nancy Knudsen. We're not going to do surveys, see what people want. If you feel strong enough about whether you like two services, whether you like one service, that type of thing, it's your responsibility to get a hold of those committee members and express your opinion, and then they're going to come up with a plan and present it to council. So that's the way that will be done. Next Sunday, we're going to have a coffee to celebrate and thank Pastor Joel for his time here leading us in worship. A little note to the council members that are here, we will be serving the coffee next Sunday. So I kind of pulled a page out of Harris's book there. I didn't tell anybody from the congregation and appoint or tell people what they're going to do. So he used to do that to me all the time. So if you can be here, we're going to order some more rolls. Please make a point to come down, and maybe you'll have a few more jokes for us or that type of thing. But please come down. If you're out of town, you know you're not going to be able to make it, please take time today after service to thank Pastor Joel for his time here. Today was probably, you know, a peak for us, right, before the minister comes. It's been a long time since we got the last year to say, look, have fun and smile, and that's where we're going. A couple other things quickly going on. The library project, if you haven't had a chance to stop in there, please poke your head in the door and take a look. The refurb of the windows and doors, the painting, the carpet, all that is complete. We ordered new chairs, and Harris told me they're in boxes, and the conference table is coming this week. So by next next weekend, we should have a new table and chairs in place, and we'll probably be able to hold our first council meeting in there April 11th. And that room, or rooms, will be available for all the groups in the church to use, and it should be really nice. It'll be cool in the summer and warm in the winter, which is just the opposite of what they have been. A lot of the money spent in that library has come from different groups within the church. It's come from a few of my memorials from a member of the church. We do have a few other things we'd like to do in there yet. We can raise the money, or we need to kind of see where we're at because we're getting our bills together. So if you would so choose and want to give some money towards the library project, you think it's a good deal, please feel free to do so. And the last thing is, next Saturday, there'll be a silent auction. Property management is having a silent auction in the far east side of the north end, I believe. What it is lots of leftover stuff from the preschool, Sunday school stuff, and also some other items at the church that have just been around for a long time. And going through this house cleaning process, we thought that was the best way, was to give the congregation a chance to bid on some of that stuff. The stuff that doesn't sell will then be offered up to the preschools in the community, and then from that point probably dispersed to other places that could use it. Thank you.
Thank you, Scott. Pastor Melinda has a well-deserved Sunday off, and we pray this time will be a time of renewing for her and her family. I'd like to say thanks to Ruth, Harris for reading today, and all who read. Margaret Oakland and family for ushering, Morgan, Nicole, and Tyler for acolyting, the communion service, Brooke and Heather, the video, Carol. Carol does that very often. She's very faithful in doing that. Al normally is here, but Brad is taking it this morning, and Hope, as well as Sharon and Pat, and all who are on the altar field. The radio broadcast, the live streaming, and the flowers are given in memory of Ruth Tweeten from the Tweeten family, but the flowers today are to remember what would have been, because this would be the day, the 67th wedding anniversary of Ruth and Jim. I believe that all the announcements were given that I was going to give, so I don't have to do that. Please stand for the offertory. Would you keep up thy own? Please note what it says. Sing the first, sing the last, and la 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 la. Given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me. Please join me in praying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated at the table of the Lord this morning. Christ bless you and keep you now and into all eternity.
Amen.
Please join me for the benediction. God has blessed you to make you a blessing. He wants to give through your hands, smile through your face, care through your heart, speak through your voice, and shine through your eyes. Amen.
Let it be so.
And our closing hymn.